There's a hope for all who've gone astray. There's a road for all who've lost their way. There's a light that leads us back to grace. Forever shining, it never fades. There's revival stirring in my heart. Since your love unlocked these prison bars, and I'm a slave no longer to the dark. Forever changed, forever yours. Oh, Jesus, you're my liberty. From the grave there won't tell me. I'm running to you wild and free. My liberty, my liberty. There's mercy flowing through my veins. With every heartbeat I can feel your grace, and it's a freedom I cannot explain. Oh, forever changed, forever yours. Oh, Jesus, you're my liberty. From the grave there won't fail me. I'm running to you wild and free. My liberty.
Read with me Psalms 9, verses 9 and 10. The Lord is a refuge for the oppressed, a stronghold in times of trouble. Those who know your name trust in you, for you, Lord, have never forsaken those who seek you.
Unto thee, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. Unto thee, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. O my God, I trust in thee. Let me not be ashamed, let not mine enemies triumph over me.
Yea, let none that way on me be ashamed. Yea, let none that way on me be ashamed. Oh my God, I trust in thee. Let me not be ashamed, let not mine enemies triumph.
Oh my God,
I trust.
Let's open Lord in prayer. Father God, thank you. Thank you for the opportunity we have to gather together in your name. Thank you for the opportunity we have to gather together throughout, not just in the area, to worship you and to lift your name on high. Father, as we come together in heart, we pray that we can serve you with our hearts, to give all of our beings to you and glorify you and give you all glory, honor, and praise. This we pray in your Son's holy and precious name. Amen. I just want to say thank you and welcome to everyone who's here this morning. And also those who are watching online. We have this wonderful opportunity that we can worship our Lord wherever we are. And because of our relationship with Him, we get to glorify Him.
To you, Jesus. When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my life, thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul, it is well,
it is well
with my soul,
with my soul,
it is well,
it is well
with my soul.
My sin, know the bliss of this glorious thought. My sin, not in part, but the whole, is nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, oh my soul.
It is well,
it is well
with my soul,
with my soul.
It is well,
it is well
with my soul. The day when my face shall be sigh, the clouds be rolled back as a scroll,
the trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul.
It is well,
it is well
with my soul,
with my soul.
It is well,
it is well
with my soul.
Hear the voice of love that's calling. There's a chair that waits for you, and a friend who understands everything you're going through. But you keep standing at a distance in the shadow of your shame. But there's a light of hope that's shining. Won't you come and take your place and bring it all to the table? Nothing he ain't seen before. For all your sin, all your sorrow and your sadness, there's a Savior and he calls. Bring it all to the table. He can't see the weight you carry, fears and hope joy.
cross you've been forgiven. You're accepted as you are. So bring it all to the table. It's nothing he ain't seen before. For all your trials, all your worries and your burdens, there's a Savior and he calls. Bring it all to the table. Nothing he ain't seen before. For all your sin, all your sorrow and your sadness, there's a Savior and he calls. Bring it all to the table.
This morning as we gather together, we're gathering for a lot of reasons, but one of the reasons for us to remember what Christ did for us. Each week through communion, we remember and proclaim the gift of salvation we have received because of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ on the cross. With that in mind, listen to what the author of the book of Hebrews wrote in Hebrews 2. But we do not see him who was made for a little while lower than the angels, namely Jesus. Because of the suffering of death, crowned with glory and honor, so that by the grace of God, he might taste death for everyone. For it was fitting for him, for whom all things and through whom all things, in bringing many sons to glory, to perfect the author of their salvation through sufferings. Very quickly, I want to point out three things. Jesus gave up everything and chose to be made lower than the angels for us. He came willingly. Second, he came so that he might taste death for everyone, not a select few, for everyone. And third, he is the author of salvation. He suffered to bring salvation, to provide a way of deliverance from judgment from sins that we all rightly deserve. He paid our payment. When you take the bread, when you take the cup, take a moment to thank our Lord for what he did so that you were able to be delivered from the rightful judgment of your sins. Let's pray. Father God, thank you. Thank you for the opportunity you give us to gather together each week, to honor you, to remember what you did, to proclaim the message of your Son, of the cross of salvation. Father, as we take of the bread, as we take of the cup, I ask you to bless them so that we can be used to glorify your name. I ask you to bless each person who's partaking so that our actions proclaim your love. Father, we thank you and we praise you in your Son's holy and precious name. Amen. Let's read together the good confession. I believe with all my heart that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. Good morning.
Good morning.
There is a couple of passages in the Gospels where you can see the example of when it comes to investing in the kingdom. This story here, it probably was a true story in the life of a good Samaritan. Luke chapter 10, verse 25 forward. There was this road, I think the Jericho Road is called, but it was dangerous for people to travel along that road all by themselves. Well, this guy who we assume is a Jewish man, was a businessman traveling there, was ambushed by thieves. And he was robbed and he was beat up. He was left actually there for dead, almost naked there. And two guys came back that are in relationship to the law and to religion. One was a priest and the other one a Pharisee. And both of these guys, the account says that they actually move as far as they could from where the body was. So in reality, they didn't even know if this guy was dead, because they went that way.
kind of like right now how we are living with masks here and there and everywhere. And then another guy showed up. Read it at home. Chapter 10 of Luke, verse 25 forward. This other guy who was a Samaritan. We, just about all of us, know that the relationship between Jews and Samaritan was not pleasant. The Jews considered Samaritans almost like if they were dogs. But this Samaritan went near where the body was and saw this guy wounded, all beat up. And so, and the whole thing came because somebody wanted to test Jesus and see what Jesus said about this. And so, the man, the good Samaritan, verse 33. A Samaritan, as he traveled, came where the man was, and when he saw him, he took pity on him. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, pouring oil and wine. Then he put the man on his own donkey, took him to an inn and took care of him. That's just what he directly did for this guy. Again, to me, this is start to invest in the, on the actions that you do, on the things that you and I do. Let's go to verse 35. Well, before that, you see all the things that he did, right? He was hands-on with the guy. Wounded, he poured wine and oil and cleaned him up. And it would have been easy for him to just sit it up and leave it there at some rocks. But he took the time to put him in his own limousine, the donkey. And I went away with him. The next day he took the next day he took out 2 silver coins and gave them to the innkeeper. There is a hotel somewhere in there. Look after him, he said, and when I return, I will reimburse you for an extra expense that you may have. So now he is not just hands-on, but now he is do this, and when I come back at my return, probably he had seek that place before in his troubles. And the innkeeper knew him, and he says, okay. And so, if we think that this guy was investing in the kingdom of God at the moment that his paycheck or wallet or credit card or cash came out, we're not understanding this. He started way back when he saw this man whom he thought he was dead. And he went. And Jesus comes with the question now. He says, which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? And there is no other way but to say the Samaritan. The Samaritan. Jesus closes this with this. Go and do likewise. Every opportunity that comes to you or comes to me to do something for the kingdom of God, to attract, to bring the wounded, the downcast, It's an opportunity every day to invest in the kingdom of God by helping out. If nothing else, help him out. And as much as you can know, help him out. But if you can't help, then go to someone and say, hey, there's this guy or this person down. Can you help him? I will pay you for whatever expense. And so the statement of Jesus at the end of the parable here is, go and do likewise. This is the challenge for all of us, right? That when we are outside of the walls of the church, we do things like that. Because the kingdom of God needs us more than it needs our money. That's true. So let's make a difference with somebody out there investing in the kingdom. Father, thank you. Thank you for the way you used us. Thank you for the way you speak into our hearts. And thank you for having stories like this where we can see the heart of a person, regardless of whatever the other one is thinking of or was thinking of him, regardless of not being of the same religion or customs or background or families or nationality. Just thank you for leaving those stories for us. Help us to give you what is yours, Lord, and to do what you require from us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Our sins and griefs to bear, and what a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Have we trials and temptations? Is there trouble to the Lord in prayer. Jesus, Lord and friend, I give everything to you. Shelter, shepherd, Savior, King, I give everything to you.
Well, we do have a couple of prayers that have come in. And of praises. Prayer for Laverne. This time of year is not doing her breathing any good, I'm assuming, is part of it. And then everything else with all of her medical issues. Keep Laverne in your prayer. Cindy and Mary share a praise that none of us have had the COVID. I was talking with Mary Ellen, our friend down in Hayward this morning, and first question she asked, did anybody in the congregation? And I said, I was able to say, no one in our congregation has gotten the COVID-19. Some of us have gotten close to people who have, but none of us has yet. But Mary also shares a concern. Pray for Mary's son, Stephen. He came back from Iraq and struggles with mental health issues. And pray for Kaylee, since the fire, she hasn't been the same. So we need to keep them in our prayers. And also, Mary Ellen, the reason why she called this morning is because a friend of hers, by the name of David, was just diagnosed with stage 4 brain tumor. And so I just want to share a little bit about him. She shared that this morning, wanted me to share it with you. When David's parents found they didn't have any kids, they adopted David, and then immediately they got pregnant with someone else. And Mary Ellen was asked to be in the delivery room for when David's sister was born, and so she's been connected closely with this family, David's entire life. And David's sister told her yesterday that he had been diagnosed with stage 4 cancer. David's sister's a Christian. She doesn't know if David is or not. Also, Jill reached out to Lynn this morning. She's out of town this weekend, but she does plan to be here next week. But she asked for prayer for her friend Karen, who has been given 2 months to live, and that's where she's at, is with her friend this morning. And also continue to be with Juanita Jones and her family, dealing with all the issues of the loss of Paul. Are there any other prayers or praises this morning? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father God, thank you. Thank you for this opportunity we have to bring to you what's on our hearts and lay them before you. Thank you for allowing us to enter your throne room and share them with you. Father, I just want to lift up to Laverne. Her health has not been all the greatest lately, and with everything going on and stresses that aren't helping, Father, I ask your blessings upon her and your hand of healing upon her. Father, we also ask that you be with Mary Ellen's friend David and Jill's friend Karen, both who have illnesses that are not, the prognosis is not very good. But Father, what we pray is your hand will touch their lives. And that if they don't know you, that those around them that know you will be able to share your love with them. Father, of course, we also ask for healing in these situations. And Father, we also lift up to you Mary's son, Stephen. Father, coming back from Iraq, the struggles he has with all the different mental health issues, Father. Father, I just pray your peace can come upon him. Put someone into his life that can share the depth of your love to him, and so he can learn how much he can rest and rely upon you. Father, also be with Kaylee, with her dealing with all these things since the fire. Father, just give her peace and comfort, Lord. And Father, we again thank you and praise you that you've been keeping our family safe, our church family, from the health issues of the COVID. And Father, we continue to pray for those who are dealing with those that are sick. Father, we ask that you be with our communities, our hospitals, our first responders. Father, we thank you for your hand of protection that has been upon them. And Father, I also ask you to be with me as I share from your word. Speak through me. Allow your words to be heard and not mine. Father, we thank you and we praise you. In your son's holy and precious name. Amen. Let me ask you a question. Have you ever taken the time to ponder the name of God? When God told Moses to go to Egypt and to free the Israelites, Moses responded by asking a question. He said, when I go there and the Israelites there then come to me and ask me, well, who is it that sent you? What do I tell them? In essence, Moses was asking them, God, what's your name? And I love God's response. It's found in Exodus chapter 3. He says, I am who I am. This is what you are to say to the Israelites. I am has sent you. The Bible is full of descriptive names for God. King of kings, shepherd, kinsman redeemer, justifier, creator, friend. And as you can see from the screen, that's just a small token of the names that God that we have in God's word. This morning we are stepping away from our sermon series on the letters of John to look at our view of God. We're going to be looking at Psalms 8 this morning. Now, if you haven't turned to Psalms 8 yet, now would be a good time to do so. And as you do that, I wanted to share with you why we're looking at Psalms 8 instead. Well, as some of you know, I've been on vacation for the last couple weeks, and I didn't think I was going to have a whole lot of time to prepare a sermon for this week. And so I said to myself, I'll just go back into my archives and I will pluck out one of my sermons that I preached years ago. And I picked Psalms 8, which, by the way, I preached this sermon before I came to Hayward. So none of you have heard this one. Okay, so I'm pretty sure about that. And also I picked this one because Psalms 8 is one of my favorite scriptures. And I thought we could look at it together this morning. Now, when I was Hayward, I preached the book of Psalms. And it was this psalm, Psalms 8, that convinced me, that enticed me to preach that series. You see, the richness of the psalms, of this psalm, set the stage for all of the rest of the sermons that I preached in that. And by the way, this is the only sermon notes of that whole series that I still have. So don't ask me to redo all of those. But what I want you to do, I'm going to read the whole psalm. I want you to let David's words reach your soul. Listen to what he wrote. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. From the lips of children and infants, you have ordained praise because of your enemies, to silence the foe and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars you have set in place, what is man that you are mindful of him? The son of man that you care for him? You have made him a little lower than the heavenly beings and crowned him with glory and honor. You made him ruler over the works of your hands. You put everything under his feet, all flocks and herds, and the beasts of the field, the birds of the air, the fish of the sea, all that swim in the paths of the sea. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. I don't know about you, but that psalm gets my heart every time I read it. There's another reason why I wanted to share this psalm. It's back in verse 1. And it's that phrase, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. David is proclaiming the majesty of God's name. Majesty. Have you ever considered what that word means, majesty? Well, according to the American Heritage Dictionary, majesty means supreme authority and power. Listen to that verse with that phrase in it. O Lord, I Lord, how full of supreme authority and power is your name in all the earth. So I ask you this morning, how majestic is your God? How majestic is God to you in your life today? Have you given Him full, supreme authority and power in all of your life? To help us answer that question, we're going to consider three areas that David touched on as he proclaimed the majesty of God. And the first is being, have you considered His majesty? Listen again to verses 1 and 2. And this time I'm going to be reading it from the New American Standard Bible. He writes, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Who have displayed your splendor above the heavens. From the mouths of infants and nursing babes, you have established strength because of your adversaries to make the enemy and the revengeful cease. Have you considered the full supreme authority and power of God? Because He is Lord. Now, that phrase, He is Lord, I think we in the United States have been handicapped. And I say this because, well, we don't fully appreciate what it means to have a Lord over us. We kind of look at God as a father, which He is, as a friend, as someone who looks after us and takes care of us when we need it. He's all of that. But when it comes right down to it, we still feel that we get to make the final decisions in our life. Too often, we don't look at God as Lord, we look at Him as an advisor. So let's talk a little bit about what is a Lord. And first of all, a Lord is someone who has power over life and death of those in their dominion. He has been given the power to decide the ultimate fate of all those in His kingdom. In the United States, we sometimes connect a Lord with a governor or a president, but the governor or president doesn't have that absolute power. In our society, government leaders have limited power. But that's not the description of a Lord. A Lord has that ultimate power over His subjects. A Lord is also responsible for everything under His domain. With the power over life and death comes a responsibility over what happens in their domain. And all that happens is under the control of the Lord of that region, of that kingdom, of that domain. He or she receives all the credit for what goes right and what goes wrong, whether justified or not. And with the power of life and death, and the responsibility for everything under domain, it naturally falls that the Lord is the final decision maker. All authority is given into the hands of the Lord in His kingdom. Everything, even the smallest details, are brought to the attention of the Lord. He may delegate some of that responsibility to someone, but ultimately, the decision is His. No one in His kingdom would ever think to make a decision that they knew went against the desires and wishes of their Lord. Because what the Lord says goes. Those who are part of the Lord's domain place their desire after His. If the Lord has a different plan than you do, His plan is followed. It simply comes down to this. The Lord gets to make all the rules. In the system where the Lord is the ruler, all the rules that are followed ultimately come from Him. He lays out the procedures for things to be done. He decides what the rewards and the punishments are. With that picture in your mind, let's turn about. When it comes to considering the majesty of God, we need to take this view of a Lord into consideration. God has the ultimate power over life and death. Not only physically, but spiritually. Where you spend eternity is in His hands. That's why Jesus came. To open the door to eternity of life with God. To us. God is responsible for everything under his domain. All things good, all things are good come from him. James 1:17 says this, every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. Yes, God gets the credit for everything. All the good. Have you noticed, though, that in our world, we often forget to give God credit for the good, but people are really quick to give God blame for everything that goes wrong. Yet, when things do go bad, as his children, we have this hope. Romans 8:28. And we know that God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. God does not cause all bad things to happen. He does allow bad things to happen because he sets the rules. He's the one who put things into motion. He said, if this is what happens, this is what is done, this is the consequences. And much of the bad that happens in our world is because of the consequences. But God does do this. He takes all that stuff, the good, the bad, the ugly, and he works them together for good. And God is the final decision maker. Ultimately, all things come under his control. Ultimately, he has the power to decide. Even when the book of Jonah, it's a very interesting story. There's a lot of chapters in it. But ultimately, the story is this. Satan was up bragging before God, and God said, have you considered my servant Jonah? And Satan says to God, he's doing really good. He's honoring you because you protect him. Take your protection away. So God allowed him to take everything that he had away, allowed Satan to take everything he had, and he lost everything. And then Satan went back and said, see, look at that. And God said, have you looked? He still has not turned his back on me. And says, well, what about his health? He still has his health. So God allowed him to take his health away. He lost everything. He lost his health. He lost his kids, his cattle, everything. And he did lose his wife. But she did say to him, curse God and die. Which, us men, we like to point that one out. The women don't like me to do that too often. But the whole thing is, the whole point that I think that we see in this book is Satan couldn't do anything without God allowing it. God does not allow us to be tempted beyond what we are able to endure. But with the temptation, he provides us the way of escape. Helps us to stand up under it. Someone might think, no, God is the final decision maker, and ultimately all things come under his control. Ultimately he has the power to decide. Now someone might think that they decide what happens, but the reality is, ultimately God has the last word. What God says goes. Psalms 119, King David wrote, all your words are true. All your righteous laws are eternal. What God says goes. And finally, God gets to make all the rules. Simply put, since God created the world and everything in it, he has the right to decide how things happen and the rules that guide it. I know I went through those very quickly, but I just want us to set the stage and understand that God is Lord. And all those things I talked about, God has control of. When David wrote Psalms 8, he didn't just declare that God was Lord. He wrote, O Lord, our Lord. And that means that he is our Lord. I want you to think about what that means. What does it mean that God is our Lord? What does it mean to claim that He is your Lord? It means that He has the power over my life. He is responsible for me. He gets to make the final decision in my life. He says what goes for me, and He sets the rules that I follow. Remember what the word majesty entails? His supreme authority and power. It's not that we choose when He has supreme authority and power in our lives. When He becomes Lord, we are to turn everything, every part of our lives over to Him. He always has supreme authority and power in our lives. As we consider His majesty, His supreme authority and power, realize that He has not left us to look blindly around, trying to find where He may have hidden His authority. Because God is everywhere. Listen again to verse 1 of Psalms 8. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Think about that for a moment. His authority does not just end with His people. He doesn't just have authority over Christians. His power is not just affecting those who call Him Lord. His authority and His power is everywhere over everything and everybody. So I ask you, does God have supreme authority and power over you? Or are you still trying to be the final decision maker, delegating God to just your chief advisor? Look at verses 3 and 4 of Psalms 8. This is from the New Living Translation. When I look at the night sky and see the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars you set in place, what are mere mortals that you should think about them, human beings that you should care for them? With that in mind, have you considered His creation? The entire first chapter of Genesis tells of God creating the heavens and the earth. And yes, I know that there is still debate between creation and evolution. Was there a creator? Did everything just evolve? Now, some theologians have tried to combine the two. But I just want to say up front, I'm not going to deal with that topic. As a Christian, my faith is in the Word of God. And I believe that it has stood the test of time. I have seen evidence of His truth in my life and in the lives of others. And everything I can test with God's Word has passed the test. And I will put my faith in Him and His Word. And there is nothing that I've seen that disproves God as Creator. And so when you consider His creation, realize that God created the heavens. Everything you see in the sky, the sun and the moon and the stars, God created. And what's so beautiful about this is the bigger they make the telescopes, the further that scientists can look and see, the greater in wonder and awe and beauty we see. God created the heavens. Not only that, God created everything. There's nothing that you can see that that the hand of God was not responsible for creating. Plants, animals, mountains, seas, and rivers. Now, when I was teaching as a youth minister, every time I would make that kind of comment, one of the kids would raise their hand at this point and say, but what about, and they will mention something that man had created, like a car or a house, but I would come back with this. Name one thing in that object that does not have something that has something that God did not create. And where it mentioned, I say, but God made that metal. And when it really comes down to it, God made the mind of man to give him the creativity to come up with those things. Everything we create starts with his creation. When it comes down to God create everything, have you considered the reality that God created you? Psalms 139, we read, and this is from the Christian Standard Bible. For it was you who created my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. God was hands-on when it was when it came to creating you. Think about that the moment. Everything that makes you, you. Everything. God created. So let me ask you, does God have supreme authority and power over his creation? Over you? I find it interesting that God doesn't compel us to turn our very lives over his authority. Instead, he's laid out his plan for us and waits on us to hand him the deed to our lives. Think about that. He doesn't impose. He waits. And he waits knowing that what is best for you is for you to turn the deed of your life over to his hands. To not just acknowledge the fact that he is Lord, but to accept the reality that he is your Lord. The last area that David addresses when it comes to the majesty of God is found in verses 5 through 8. David writes, "You made him a little less than God and crowned him with glory and honor. You made him ruler over the works of your hands and put everything under his feet. All the sheep and oxen, as well as the animals in the world, the birds of the sky, and the fish of the sea that pass through the currents of the sea." So you considered his gifts. Usually when we talk about gifts from God, we're referring to the spiritual gifts that he's given his children. But if you considered the gifts he's given to all mankind, those are the gifts that David is pointing to in this beautiful psalm, emphasizing the majesty of God. God gave us the gift of exalted status. You made him a little less than God. I know that in some translations, some of your translations say made him a little less than the angels. In other translations, a little less than heavenly beings. As well as some that says a little less than God. There's reason for the confusion. The Hebrew word that's used here is mi Elohim. And when you look that word up, it says that the exact meaning of this word is not certain. I love it when they say that. But I want to point something out to you. The word is mi Elohim. Elohim is a word used for God. For God himself. But my point really is this. No matter how one translates that Hebrew word, a little lower than God, a little lower than angels, or even a little lower than the heavenly beings, you can't miss the point that David is making. God has exalted the status of man. For you see, the status God gave man is the pinnacle of his creation. In Genesis 1, God said, "Let us make mankind in our image." In verse 27, we read, "So God created mankind in his own image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them." We are made in the likeness of God. This is an exalted status. None of God's other creation, other than mankind, has been created in the image of God. But even more so, God gave the gift of glory and honor. That same verse, "You made him a little less than God and crowned him with glory and honor." God placed his creation, man, at the top of his creation. And this shows me that God's attitude towards mankind, towards you and I. God values you and I, mankind, greatly. And we can see this level of value when we consider what he did for us through Jesus Christ. John 3:16, for God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish, but have everlasting life. That is a high level of glory and honor. But it doesn't stop there. Back to verse 6 to 8. It says, you made him ruler over the works of your hands. You put everything under his feet, all the sheep and oxen, as well as the animals in the world, the birds of the sky, the fish of the sea that pass through the creation. He put us over all. Now, where would David get that from? Well, back in Genesis chapter 1, back to verse 26, let me read the entire verse. And then God said, let us make mankind in our own image, in our likeness, so that they may rule over the fish of the sea, the birds of the sky, over the livestock and all the wild animals, and over all the creatures that move along the ground. God gave mankind the gift of authority. Just like the Lord of his domain, he gave us the just like the Lord of a domain, authority to rule certain areas are often delegated to others. God chose to delegate the authority to rule over the creation to mankind. Yet this authority to rule over God's creation is not absolute. I know some people try to teach that, but it's not. We are to exercise our authority in the name of our Lord. We are to treat our land and the animals in it in such a way that gives glory and honor to God. As a matter of fact, all that we do, since all that we are, belong to God and should be done to honor him. We should not make any choices in dealing with what God has placed under us without asking, what would God want us to do? Because we may have authority over the animals, but we have that authority under God. So let me ask you, does God have supreme authority and power over his gifts to you? God has given us so much. He has blessed us over and over and over again. It is so easy to just live with the blessings he has given us. But doesn't God deserve more? All that we are, all that we see, all that he is screams out to us, telling us our God is an awesome God. With all things considered, his majesty, his creation, his gifts, we see all of that. We see his love for us. So I ask you again, how majestic is your God? How much authority and power does he have over your life? In a moment, we're going to be singing the song, How Majestic Is Your Name, O God. And as we sing this song, I want you to really place yourself in the spot of seeing God with full authority and power over everything.
Majestic is your name in all the earth. Oh, Lord,
Father God, thank you. Thank you for allowing us to be able to experience and to see the majesty that you are. Father, so often we think of majesty of just thinking of how wonderful and great. But as we saw in God's word, in your word, that it goes beyond that. It's not a thought, but it's an action and experience. Father, we as your children, help us to remember that you have a supreme authority and power over not our lives, but this world. And that we are able to place in you our lives, knowing that you have what's best for us. Father, as we leave here, as we go this week, I ask that you help us to keep our hearts open to you and to listen to you and to follow you and live our lives in such a way that you receive all glory, honor, and praise. Father, this we pray in your Son's holy and precious name. Amen.
Though the tears may fall, my song will rise to you. Though my heart may fail, my song will rise to you. While there's breath in my lungs, I will praise you, Lord. In the dead of night, I'll lift my eyes to you. Though the waters rise, I'll lift my eyes to you. While there's hope in this heart, I will praise you, Lord. The joy of presence now I come alive. I